Good morning. My name is Frank Piessens. I'm a professor in software security here in the University of Leuven. I'll talk today about access control. That's not immediately the most hot, sexy topic of the moment. I mean, this is an old school, well-studied, also fairly well-understood problem, also for which the solutions are fairly well understood. However, it's still an important and interesting topic for a number of reasons. One is it remains challenging to implement access control well, in particular at application level. So we'll spend a bit of time on trying to give you some insights and best practices in that realm. And secondly, as always in computer science, things move fast and we see new challenges. And one of these new challenges is the fact that we need to do more and more software access control, in the sense that we also don't trust part of the software. I'll explain a bit more what that problem brings to the problem of access control, why access control becomes more challenging because of that. And we look at some new challenges and more new research level solutions that people are looking at this point in time. So even though it's an old problem, I still hope, well, first that getting to know the state of practice will be useful for a number of you, and then we'll see that even though it's an old problem, there are new problems, new sub-problems that are part of it. And that leads me to, okay, I'll have to manually switch the slides, I guess. So that leads me to the following overview of the talk. I'll first give a very brief introduction to access control old style. So, I mean, this is a problem studied since the 60s. The first model, general model of access control was done by Butler Lampson, a later a Turing Award winner. You'll see it's a very simple model. It's very broadly applicable. And then we look at the state of practice for user-based access control. We'll look at two things essentially. First thing is so access control are the rules about who is allowed to do what, very informally speaking. And we'll look about both how to choose the rules that you want to enforce. These are access control models. So what do you want to enforce? What are the security properties you want? What are the desirable rules for the kind of application you're looking at? And there the challenge is, there are a number of existing, what we call classic access control models. They're well understood, they're useful, but they're typically not exactly what you want when you are developing an application. So what I hope to bring across here in this first part is not only a few classic models, many of them that you will already know at least to some level of detail. What I hope to bring across here is a way of thinking about these rules, a way of thinking about access control policies that you can also apply in applications. We will use the technique of security automata for that. This is a kind of a way in which you can specify access control rules for a system. We will then look at the, let's say, more classic access control models as examples of security automata. So I will specify them for you in the form of a security automata, hoping that, well, on the site you will learn what they are if you don't know them yet, but many of you will already know them. But on the site you will also learn how to think about access control models using security automata. And maybe that is more important than getting to know the classic models themselves. Because, well, if you do a modern application, think, for example, about the social network application, then you will not, it will not be sufficient to just use these two classical models. You need to think about things like, if you have a post on a picture, the picture is taken by one person, it shows a second person, the comment is made by a third person and refers to a fourth person. Who is allowed to edit that comment? Who is allowed to change things in that comment? These are difficult rules. It's difficult to come up with correct rules for that. And so an important objective here is to give you reasoning techniques, to give you modeling tools that will help you come up with good policies for that. You have similar things in workflow-based access control, so the classical models are not very dynamic, you'll see that, but in many modern applications, what somebody is allowed to do depends on in what phase of the process you are. So if you want to think about these kinds of complex access control policies, knowing what security automata are, knowing how to work with them, hopefully will help you. So this will help you with doing access control at the design level. Then we'll focus on implementation techniques. Okay, so it's very good to come up with a set of rules, an unambiguous set of rules and a good set of rules, but then the next challenge is how do you implement them? We'll spend some time on that, and there's a variety of implementation techniques, all with advantages and disadvantages. So I'll give you a bit of an overview of the implementation options that you have at your disposal. And that finishes, in a sense, the state of practice in user-based access control. And then in a second part, or third part if you count the introduction, I'll look at somewhat next challenges. So what happens if you throw untrusted software in the mix, if you cannot trust all the software running on the system on which you're doing access control? Again, this is in principle an old problem, and I'll explain why this was already a problem in the early days and how people thought about it then, and that this is how they came up with mandatory access control and lattice-based access control and so forth. That didn't work for some reasons, and I'll explain why. And then I'll explain that this problem is coming back to us. If you have things like, for example, on the web, for example, on mobile platforms, we see similar problems coming back. I'll explain that. And I'll talk a little bit, and this will be depending on amount of time available, about how the research community is thinking to solve this. So these are new ways of access control, sometimes called usage control, information flow control, and so forth. We'll talk about what they are and how they are relevant to this new setting, what they bring in addition to the more classic access control models. And I also have a very brief part about implementation techniques. Of course, here we have a lot of experience with implementation techniques. Here, this is much more fresh, and it's harder to give advice on what the best implementation technique is. Okay, that's more or less the overview of what we'll talk about today. Before we start on the technical content, let me emphasize that you're very welcome to interrupt me at any time. It's very difficult to scope the content for a session like this, access control. I mean, it's very broad. So it's okay to interrupt me at any point with questions about something related to what I'm saying, unclarities, if something that I'm saying is not entirely clear, interrupt me, I will try to explain. Challenge me, if I give you an advice and you think, no, it's not good to do that, raise your hand, challenge me, and I will discuss with you, and we'll see, maybe you're right, maybe I'm right, maybe nobody's right, maybe it depends on the context. All that is welcome, so don't hesitate to interact. Whenever you feel it is useful. Okay, damn it. So, as an introduction to access control, first to scope the problem very broadly, if you think of security as techniques to prevent and or detect unauthorized actions on information, that's a very informal and broad definition, then you can distinguish two important subcases of that security problem. And one is the case where the attacker has access to the raw bits that represent the information. And this is the case, for example, if the attacker can sniff the cable, the network cable on which information is being transmitted. This is the case if information is being transmitted wirelessly and the attacker can put an antenna there and listen to the bits. This is the case when an attacker can steal your hard disk or he steals your phone. Then he can take out the storage medium and he will have access to the actual bits that represent the information that you care about. Yeah? In this case, all you can do is cryptography. I mean, you need cryptography to protect you. Once the attacker can see the actual bits representing the information, all you can do is make these bits unintelligible. So you will encrypt them or protect them in one way or another with a secret key such that these bits look random to anybody who has direct access to them. I'll not talk about any of that today. So there are plenty of excellent sessions on cryptography later this week, and they'll handle that or different sub-aspects of that case of security. But there's a second important case that is where there is some kind of software layer that you as a defender control between the attacker and the information that you care about. the prototypical, very simple example is if the attacker is accessing a server, so the attacker can send requests to the server, he can look at the responses coming from the server, but he cannot immediately access the data behind, for example, not immediately access the database or the hard disk of the server. So you have this piece of server software in that case, for example, a database management system, that is sitting between the attacker and the actual data. And in that case, this is where access control plays an important role, of course. So you as a defender get to structure that software layer. Of course, you don't want it to do nothing. I mean, regular users should be able to access stuff. On the other hand, you want to write it in such a way that it enforces certain rules on how information or resources of the system can be accessed. And that's access control. So in a sense, this is much simpler than crypto, because you get to write the software that enforces something. You have this extra power. You can write, in the first case, you have no means of intervening, in a sense. In the second case, at least you have that means. It's also more complicated, because typically, the kind of rules that you want to enforce here get to become much more complicated than the kind of rules that you want to enforce here. Here, you typically want make it impossible for anybody who is sniffing the wire to understand or change anything. A relatively simple rule, even though it may be hard to implement, the rule is relatively simple. In this case, you typically get to have very complex rules. I gave you the example of the social network before, where you may want to have complicated rules like, yeah, if somebody is a friend of that guy or is in that picture, he may be able to add some metadata to it but not delete it, and so forth. So this is, the rules here are much more, that you want to enforce, are much more complicated, and hence there's also much more room for mistake, and that's where access control typically tends to go wrong. Okay, so what's the general model that we'll use for access control? It is actually very simple. We'll zoom in a minute and see more details. But we talk about access control when we have some kind of protected system. Think about it as a server, think about it as a database, think about it as an operating system. We'll see plenty of examples in a minute. Think about it as your phone, for that matter. We have a variety of entities, we'll call them principles, that want to do actions on that system. Users may want to interact with the server, machines may want to send messages to other machines, programs can be principles, may want to do actions on a certain protected system. So we have entities, principles, doing actions on some kind of system that we care about enough to want to protect it. And then for access control, what we'll do is, we will put something in the middle here. An old name for this is the reference monitor. You can think of it as a guard. So there is some system here sitting in between principles and the protected system. And the crucial thing is that any action that a principle can do on the protected system should be visible, should be interceptable, should be blockable by this guard here. That's called the complete mediation property. So the thing that we put in here is supposed to be able to see everything that's happening to the protected system by principles so that it can enforce some rules. That's the overall model. Extremely simple. And using this model, we can break down the access control problem in two sub-problems. Since the rules that we want to enforce typically talk about who is doing something, you're saying this guy is allowed to do something, but this guy is not. A first important part of access control is what is called authentication or entity authentication. So the guard needs to determine in one way or another who this principal is. He needs to get hard evidence that this principal is who he's claiming to be. If I come here and say, I'm Frank, I want to do something, am I really Frank? That's the question of authentication. I will only have one slide on authentication, so we'll basically consider this problem solved. We will focus on the other sub-problem. But there is a separate full session on authentication later this week. So how do you solve? So this sub-problem is not what we'll talk about today. It's a very interesting and difficult problem. It depends a lot on what kind of principles you're talking about, but we'll not zoom into that in this session. We'll zoom in on the second part, which is the authorization part. So once the guard knows who wants to do what to what part of the protected system, the guard should make some decision. allow it, not allow it, allow it but remember it has happened, because and so forth. And that's what we'll zoom in. That's the authorization part of access control, and that's what we'll zoom in on today. We'll zoom in on the design and implementation parts. So how do you model the rules that the guard needs to enforce, and how do you actually enforce them in an implementation? Okay, so the model I've shown you is extremely abstract and simple, and so it has plenty of instantiations. So the model is everywhere. You see access control of this format in a plethora of systems in computer science. Here are some examples. A firewall, so if you look at this picture, the guard could just as well be a firewall. The protected system is your intranet, and the principles are other hosts on the internet, and the actions are packet sent and packet receive. You can think of it as an operating system. The protected system is the file system, for example. The guard is the operating system kernel that's trying to enforce some rules on how you can share files, and the principles are the users of the operating system. Principles don't have to be machines. So here, principles are machines. Here, principles are users. Principles can also be programs. For example, in the Java virtual machine, you can load new components, new programs from the internet, and control what they can do to resources on the system. In that case, the principle is a specific program. It does all kinds of actions on the virtual machine, for example, with files. And there is a guard, in this case, the Java Security Manager, that will determine what the rules are and will block or allow access to these resources. And so forth. I mentioned the example of database, website, and so forth before. So this is a very open-ended list. I think you can come up yourself with plenty of more examples along these lines. Okay, so I had one slide on authentication. This is it. So what authentication is verifying the claimed identity of an entity. So we'll call it a principle. And the solution for this session here, you can think of only very simple solutions, like say the entity is a user and will authenticate him by means of a password, and that's all you need to know. Of course, doing this well is tricky and depends a lot on context. So for example, Jim already hinted in his introductory talk that how to store passwords is a very tricky problem. In particular, authentication will yet be different if the principal is a computer instead of a human. You don't give passwords to a computer, you use some kind of crypto protocol to authenticate. If the principal is a program, it gets even more tricky. When are two programs the same? What does it mean to authenticate a program is in itself an interesting question. So for example, if you have apps on your smartphone, you may want to limit what each app can do. Well, then you need to authenticate apps. What does that mean? How do you do that? It's an interesting problem in itself. If you want to authenticate users that are accessing your system remotely, you have additional challenges, because of course you have to make sure that you don't never transmit a password in clear text. If you want to authenticate a principal, a user, running a specific piece of code, it even gets more tricky, and so forth and so forth. So entity authentication in itself is an interesting and difficult problem, but I'm not going to talk about it today. I refer you to Bart Pennell's session on entity authentication later in the week. So let us assume that for this session that the guard knows who is doing the actions. Yeah? And we will incorporate that by giving the authenticated principle as a parameter to the authorization subsystem. So it will receive the identity of whoever is trying to do something, and we will assume that this has been done securely and not care about it anymore. And you'll see in our security automata later on that indeed the current user, for example, is passed in as a parameter. Okay, so given that assumption, what else is left to play with? So what does it mean to specify access control? So we have this guard. It sees actions coming from authenticated principles coming in, going to the protected system. So what's the most general thing that the guard could do? Well, the guard could maintain state. That's one thing the guard could do. It could not do that. So I've given you the example of a firewall. You have stateless firewalls that just look at the message passing through and based on that message decide whether it's okay or not. That would be completely stateless. But in the most general case, of course, you will want the guard to remember stuff, and in the most extreme case it would remember everything it has seen, and it may make a decision on the next action based on the entire history of what it has seen. This kind of maintaining state will be essential for many policies. For example, if you have a workflow-based policy saying only if you are in this phase you're allowed to do something, then you need to remember in what phase you are. If you have a quota, you are allowed to do this at most 10 times, then you need to maintain state, of course. We'll see that actually most interesting access control policies will have to maintain some form of state. Okay, so that's one thing we'll need. We'll call that state the protection state. And I'll give you a way of structuring that state in a minute by means of security automata. So that's one thing. The second thing the guard needs to do is make a decision. And there we'll simplify a bit and we'll just assume that the guard either passes the action unmodified, so it's allowed, or it blocks it completely, it drops it. It's not allowed. Many access control systems work like that. So it's either yes or no, fail or allow. You could do other things. You could do more expressive things. Here we will take the most general approach. We'll allow any kind of state to be remembered. Here we simplify a bit, mainly because in practice it's often enough to consider only pass and drop. But alternative things that you could do here is the guard could decide when he sees an action, okay, I'm going to allow this, but before I allow it, I'm going to do something else. I'm going to update the protected system a bit. Or the guard could see an action and decide, okay, I'm going to allow this, but I'm going to change it a bit. Make it a bit more secure one way or another. So he changes the action that the user is willing to do. That is important. There are systems that do that. A good example is virtualization systems. They will typically take actions from one of the virtual machines and change them, virtualize them in a sense, and then do them on the real system. So these are important extensions, but we can talk enough about access control without considering them, so we will not do that at the moment. We can come back to it if there are questions about it later. In addition, when the guard sees an action, of course, besides his decision on whether to pass or drop it, he can also decide to change his local state. For example, he may remember the action, or he may remember some aspect of the action. Just count how many of these actions have happened, for example. Okay, so if that is all the guard can do in our model, then I think at least those of you with a computer science background will see that you can think of it as an automaton. You may have learned about finite state automata while you were studying computer science. So essentially what we have here is a machine that has different states, a state machine, and that will change state if it sees an action. And in some states, some actions will not be possible. Yeah, so that's a bit like a finite state automaton. So we will model it, we will call it a security automaton. And I'll come up with a notation that makes it easy to write these kinds of automata, these kinds of security automata on the next slide. So here's an example of a very simple such automaton. So this is the classical way in which, the graphical way in which you would represent such an automaton. You think of the guard as being in two possible states, and in each state some things are allowed and some things are not allowed. Yeah? So this expresses a guard that enforces the policy no send after read. So this kind of a privacy policy, once a user has read some local data, he's not allowed to send it over the network anymore. So as long as he hasn't read any private data, you can send. But as soon as you read something private, you can't send anymore. It's just an example of a very simple policy. So that means, in this case, the guard can be in two states. He can be in the state where nothing private has been read yet. That's the initial state. And in that state, send is possible and read is possible. And you can do as many sends as you want, and you stay in this state. As soon as you read something, something potentially confidential, you go to the other state, and from that point on, only reading is possible, you cannot send anymore. Okay? So interrupt me if something is not clear about this. We'll see this coming back plenty of times later in the session, but it's also not rocket science, of course. So it's a relatively simple concept. Now, of course, this graphical representation doesn't work very well for large numbers of states. So the access control models we'll see will have infinite numbers of states. So if we would draw them like this, it would blow up on the slide immediately. Even the simplest policies we'll talk about will have hundreds or thousands of states. So instead we will use a notation further in this presentation where we write security automata like this. So we write them, this is actually an existing notation called spec sharp. The details of the syntax are not important. You can think of it as being Java or C sharp classes with some extensions. So what we have is instance variables that represent the state. So here, if you have only two states, you can represent them with a Boolean, a single Boolean. Yeah? If hasRed is false, we are in this state, and then in this state, hasRed is true. And you can see that representing state in that way, well, you can much more easily represent big state spaces. For example, if you make this an integer, you immediately have an infinite, or at least 2 to the 32 states, whereas if you would draw that as a graph, it's basically impossible. And we can have lists and sets and so forth as instance variables, which immediately gives us an infinite state space. Okay? And then the actions, we will write them as a kind of methods, functions, with preconditions. So each action, important is you don't think of this as code, think of this as specification. So we will not implement the access control rules exactly in this way. We will see implementation techniques later on. It's just a very specific way of thinking about the rules. Okay? So we will have for every action that the protected system supports, we will have a method in the security automaton. For example, this system, this very simple system, just supports send and read, and that's it. So we have a send method and a read method. And these are classic Java C-sharp methods in the sense that they can, when they are called, update the state. That's what we want, of course. If you see a certain action happening, the protection state may be updating. And they have one additional extra, which is a form of precondition, which essentially specifies whether this action in the current state is allowed, yes or no. Yes? So that's the only extension we do with respect to a classical Java or C sharp class. Well, we'll have some more high level notation, but essentially that's all that's different from a standard Java, let's say. And we write the precondition in this way, requires, and then a Boolean condition. The Boolean condition can talk about the state and can talk about the current action, for example, the parameters of the method that's being called here. That's not used here, but we'll use it later. Okay? And so how you should think about this is this condition specifies whether this action in the current state is allowed, yes or no. So here the only method, the only action that has a precondition is send. It's the only one that's sometimes forbidden, and it is forbidden, it's only allowed when hasRed is false, hence requires not hasRed. Okay? So this is a very simple example. We'll see a much more complicated example later, and we can dig into the notation if something is unclear there at that point too. Okay, so with that as preliminaries aside, we can now start to think about actual access control policies and how to implement them. So I'll first talk about the policies. So what is an access control policy? Well, informally, it's the rules that say what is allowed and what not. This includes, and that's important, who is allowed to change the rules. Yeah? So we will, in many cases, access control will be dynamic in the sense that what you are allowed to do changes in the course of time. So we will also have to specify how that changing happens. So if you're not allowed to access the file today, then some things happen and you're allowed to access it tomorrow. How exactly, how can that happen? Who is allowed to say that you can now access that file and so forth is also part of the policy. Yeah? More specifically, so this is very informal, very precisely, a policy is a security automaton in a particular state. Yeah? So we have some machine, the guard is configured with such a security automaton, and that answers all the questions of what anybody is allowed to do now or in the future. Yeah? So we can just take any set of actions, any trace of actions, display them, and then see how the guard reacts to it, and then we know what has been allowed and what has not been allowed. Yeah? So we can be very precise about that, and we'll do that for all the policies I'll talk about. I will give you an actual security automaton, that then indeed in detail spells out what is allowed and what is not. And I consider this an important learning objective of this session too. So the fact that you use these specification vehicles to think about your access control policies is just as important as the actual access control policy that we'll talk about. Because in most cases, when you do access control for your own application, you will have to come up with your own policy. And then it's interesting to think about it precisely, for example, using this kind of mechanism. So that's what the policy is. Now you also have the term access control model. What is that? And that's less easy to define that precisely. So an informal definition would be, it's a class of policies with similar characteristics. And when we talk about the discretionary access control model or the role-based access control model, you have plenty of these role-based access control policies, discretionary access control policies, workflow-based policies, team-based access control policies, and so forth. So we talk about an access control model, you should think about it as kind of a template, a design pattern for policies. It's a class of policies that looks the same in some essential way. So typically, such a model makes particular choices about what is part of the protection state and how that is used. How that is used. We'll see examples in a minute when we talk about the discretionary access control model. So an access control model is, in a sense, think of it as a design pattern for your own access control policies. It gives you some guidelines on how you should start with setting up these rules. Okay, that with these terms defined, let's look at some examples. And I'll discuss two fairly well-known and important examples to start with. The first is discretionary access control. This is the access control model that's been around for years and years, that is the basis of access control in all multi-user operating systems. So all of you know it at least to some extent. I hope that you will see as part of the discussion that there are many intricacies there, and understanding all the details is still non-trivial, even though you may be working with it every day. But it's good that you already at least know a bit about it, because this will help you also understand the notation of security automata, for example. So I will specify exactly what discretionary access control is by means of a security automata. So okay, let's start from the helicopter overview. So what's the objective of discretionary access control? The key idea, the one-line summary of discretionary access control is, the creator of an object decides who can do something with that object. It's creator control sharing of information. And you see that basic principle coming back in many, many systems. So the prime example being the classical operating systems, but you also see that in applications. You create something, you get to own it, and you get to decide who further has access to it. That's the essence of discretionary access control. So the principles in this model are typically users, not programs. The protected system, we think of the protected system as managing objects, where you should think of an object just as an information container. The prototypical example here is the file system with files, but you could just as well think of a social network application with pictures and or blog posts or comments and so forth. So you have some information containers called objects. These are accessed by means of operations on them. So again, think of files and opening them for read, reading from them, closing them, and so forth. These are the typical operations that you would have. On a picture, you could have view, copy, and so forth. Now, what we add from the point of view of the access control model is every object needs to have an owner, and that will be part of the protection state. So the guard will remember for each object in the protected system who owns that object. And that will determine to a big extent what the rules are with respect to that object. And so then this is the what I said before, the owner gets to decide who can use various operations on the objects that he has created. Now this sounds extremely simple, but once you start to drill down in details, this blows up on you. Even for operating system access control, on which people have been working for 40 years or longer, still refinements are being done. So if you look at, for example, the history of the Windows access control system, this gets more tricky and complicated. They complicate the model in order to make the user experience of working with the model more pleasant. And this is a process that's been going on for 30 years. To give you an idea of some of the issues that you need to think about, So, let's assume that we have this as base guidelines. Now we can start asking ourselves questions. First is, if I'm the owner of the object, can I pass ownership on to others, yes or no? That's an important design decision. Either an owner is fixed for life, or I get to create something and say, now this belongs to you and you get to decide everything. Should we support that, yes or no? This has important impact on the security properties of the system that you're building. And it's a choice you make. Now we're talking about design of the rules. Delegation is another tricky thing. So the base rule is I as owner get to decide what others can do. Can I delegate that right? Can I as owner say, okay, I want to stay the owner, but I want to give you the possibility to also give rights to others. That's called delegation. Yeah? Again, do you want it or do you not want that? From a security point of view, it's dangerous because people get more privileges. From a management perspective, it may be useful because you don't have to do all the security administration yourself, in a sense. You can delegate subtasks. Again, let's go a bit more complicated. So suppose you do support delegation, then an interesting question becomes revocation. So suppose I delegate the right to give people access to my objects to you, and at some point I change my mind. I say, now you cannot do that anymore. You cannot you're no longer a delegate for me. You can no longer exercise my own rights. What should I do at that point with all the rights that you have handed out in the past? Should we just keep them? Should we revoke all the rights that you have handed out? If I found out you're a fraud or you're cheating me, maybe I want to revoke everything you've ever done with my objects. Again, it's a design choice. Maybe you want to make this possible or maybe not. All this is part of designing an access control model. And I think I hope at least with this last example, you can already start to see that, well, supporting this kind of revocation is useful, might be useful at least in some scenarios, but it will immensely complicate the implementation of the system. You will need to the guard will need to remember much more if it has to be able to do this kind of revocation even years after you have delegated something and you want to be able to revoke. This will also lead to challenges, clearly. Okay? So I do that just to show that coming up with a good policy, and this is a well-known and well-studied policy, in an application you'll typically have a much less well-understood policy, complicated design trade-offs that you need to be aware of. And these are just some examples, there are many more. Another interesting one is, what if you have container objects? So you have one object that has sub-objects, like a folder or a directory and files. Is there a relation if you allow somebody access to the container? Do you also immediately allow access to the files, yes or no? Again, both choices are valid. You need to think about what you want to do. And this is one of the areas in which operating systems have been evolving a lot. In order to make, for example, permissions on a file system as intuitive as possible, the way in which, for example, Windows deals with inheritance of permissions across containers is fairly intricate. So even understanding the rules is non-trivial. Okay? Okay, so I hope I've convinced you that even for simple policies, it's not trivial to think through all the details. So what I would give you as advice, what I think is a good thing to do, is when you have to make your own access control system, is to be very specific about the rules you'll implement, and, for example, do that by specifying them by means of a security automaton. So let us write a security automaton that specifies the simplest model of discretionary access control. Okay. So ask questions if the notation is not clear. I use spec-sharp notation because it's a very convenient short notation for this. I could write it in full Java as well. It would just be a bit longer. I will explain the notation as we go over it, but if something is unclear, please don't hesitate to raise your hand. So what do I do here? I first define a new type saying that a write, an access write, is a triple that has a user, an object, and then an operation. And for simplicity, I just have read and write operations. We could have a set of operations here too, but for simplicity, there are only two. And of course, you interpret elements of that type in the obvious way. Eh? So an element of that type means that this user has this operation write on this object. Then we have, in the protection state, the guard will know all the users. It starts out as the empty set. It will know all the objects. It again starts out as the empty set. And it will know all the rights that users have on these objects. So this is what in operating system literature would be called the access control matrix. It says for every user and every object what rights you have the user has on that object. In the security automaton here, we just represent it as a set of triples. And then finally, of course, since this is discretionary access control with owners, we need to remember from each object who the owner is, and that's this owner of map. So this is a map from object to users, initially empty again, that will map every object to one user, the owner of that object. Okay. Then we see that once we have this state, The actual access checks are stateless. Well, they don't change the state. They're not stateless, they don't change the state. So whether somebody is allowed to read or write is trivial to check. What the guard needs to check is if a user whom we assume is authenticated well, so we don't care about authentication. Here is, we assume that what we get in here, what the guard gets in here as a parameter is secure, can be trusted. So if this user wants to access this object, all that the guard needs to do is check whether the specific right to read that object is in the rights set, and if so, it's allowed, and if not, it's not allowed. And the state doesn't change. Okay, is that clear? And the same for write. It's very easy. The difficult things are about the operations that change the protection state. So what are some examples of operations here? Well, here is the operation of a user wanting to give a write to another user. So we have user U who wants to give this write to user U prime. So he wants to give user U prime the write R on object O. For example, the right to read a specific file. Yeah. So what does the guard in this specific access control model need to check? The real gist of the check is here. So of course the guard will check that both are valid existing users. The object is a valid existing object. And then the real check is here. The owner of the object on which a write is being given should be the user who's doing this specific addition of writes. Okay, so that's the precondition. This operation is allowed if this Boolean condition here is true. And then how it changes the state is, this is notation for adding this triple to this set. So the write set gets extended. We think of the set as an array of elements that have true or false, whether if the element is in the set or not. So by setting this to true, we essentially say add this element to the set of writes here. And so from this point on, if the user has done that, now the recheck for this specific U prime on this specific object would pass. Okay. Similarly, for deleting write, the essential check is only the owner can do that. Another essential aspect is you see when adding an object. So if this user creates a new object, what should happen? Well, the user should be a valid existing user. The object should not yet exist, otherwise you cannot create the same object twice. And then the state gets updated. The object O is added to the set of objects. And then the owner map is updated to say the owner of this object becomes the creator. Remember, our goal was creator-controlled access to information. So here we store who the owner of the object was. And then we can go on, and there can be many other of such operations, and you specify them all in the same way. Let me do one more example. So here's the deletion of an object. Again, the essential thing here in the precondition is that only the owner can do it. This is a choice, again, that we make in this particular instantiation of the discretionary access control model. We remove the object from the set of objects, we remove it from the owner of map, and we remove all the rights pertaining to this object from the right set. And that's how. Yes? That's a good question. Again, that's a design choice. So the way in which I specify it here, when you create an object, nobody has any rights to it. And then as a next step, you as the owner should add rights for yourself, for example, and maybe for others too. But it would be a sensible choice to here also immediately give you as an owner rights to the object. That's a valid, but it's not necessary, it's a choice. What would you give by default? Read access, write access, or both? There's no choice that works for everything. So the choice here is to say, okay, we give nothing, and the owner himself should decide after he has created an object what rights he wants to give to himself. Yeah, but valid question. Yeah. Okay, so this is a simple model we specified with security automata. Is the notation clear? Is the model clear? Yeah. Everybody follows this easily. So about the model itself, it's a very common model, and you see it coming back. You see elements of it coming back also for application level policies. But there are also some known disadvantages of the model. In particular, administration can become very cumbersome because every user is an administrator in a sense. Every user determines the rights of the objects that he has created. So that typically also means if a user leaves or if a new user comes in, there's a lot of write setting to do. Also, if a user moves on to do some other task, there may be a lot of objects that need to be transferred from one user to another one and so forth. This is one of the things that will lead to role-based access control later on. So dealing with making sure that this kind of management of access rights becomes less cumbersome is the primary goal of role-based access control. So that's one important disadvantage. Another important disadvantage is that the fact that everybody can do everything to his own object is not necessarily very secure. So one issue is social engineering. So since you can do anything to your objects, if I can convince you to do something bad, like give world access to your objects, you can do that. And since not all users on the system may be security aware, these kinds of systems can be vulnerable to social engineering. You can call someone and say, okay, give me world access to all your objects, it will be much easier. And you may not necessarily notice that. Everything will work, but everybody can also access your objects. And then the second thing is, but I'll come back to that in the second part, is the if you combine that with potentially malicious software, so now again think of the example of operating systems, an implicit assumption in discretionary access control is that the software you use to do all these actions is trusted. It does what you want it to do. If that's not the case, if you have potentially malicious software like a Trojan horse is a program that seems to be useful to the user but in the back does all kinds of bad things. Well, a Trojan horse in a discretionary access control system can also set world access to all your objects. Yeah? So you may have an editor that you're using and behind your back it's giving world access to all your files. That's an important problem, and again we'll come back to that, how to deal with that later. There are many extensions possible to discretionary access control. I will not talk about all of them. You can put more structures on users. So instead of talking about individual users, you can consider groups of users, and then you can give rights to a group instead of to an individual user. Once you have groups, you could have negative permissions. You could say, okay, we have the group of Department of Computer Science. They can all access this object except Frank. We give Frank a negative permission, so then all the department has access except me. But experience shows that even having this structuring, and in particular having negative permissions, typically has a negative effect on making administration easy. Once you have negative permissions, keeping a good view on who can do what is getting fairly complicated. You can put more structure in the operations. Instead of having the individual operations per object, you can have access modes, like you have many operations, but some of them only observe the object and others may alter the object, and then you can give rights based on modes instead of on the actual operation. You can consider more complex operations that handle many objects, and these are called procedures. You can have a procedure that places an order and it may touch several objects, but you put a write only on that specific procedure. I already talked about structuring of the objects. So for example, the use of inheritance if you give somebody the write on a folder, then all the objects in that folder get the same write and so forth. So many extensions are possible. I won't talk about them all, but it may be interesting if you're building your own access control model and you need this kind of owner-based access control to think about whether some of these extensions also make sense in the application you're talking about. Okay, so I teach this also to the master students in computer science, and I tell them at that point an interesting exercise is we've seen this example of the security automaton for a very simple form of DAC. An interesting exercise to get some experience in playing with access control policies would be to try to implement some of these extensions. So how would you change the security automaton in order that it can deal with groups, that it can deal with inheritance of folder permissions, that it can deal with transfer of ownership and so forth? Yeah, so in that way you get to play a bit with the design space of a specific access control model. Okay, let's look at a second very popular model, access control model, role-based access control. So the main objective of role-based access control is to deal with the administration nightmare of discretionary access control. So role-based access control, people came up with it in the late 70s, early 80s, because of the issue of administering permissions in a good way. So they were looking for, in a sense, more stable abstractions with respect to the rights that individuals can have on a protected system. And a role is one of the key concepts that came out. So what role-based access control adds is the notion of role. And the best way to think of a role is as a named set of permissions that can be assigned to users. So it's a kind of, it's a structuring on top of the atomic rights that users could have on individual objects. In fact, role-based access control will no longer consider individual objects. It will just talk about permissions. And a role is a collection of permissions. And typically, you will make such a collection to be such that it's exactly the permissions that somebody needs to perform a certain function, hence the name role. For example, I may have the role of teacher at the university. In order to be able to be a teacher, I need a lot of permissions. I need to be able to reserve an auditorium. I need to be able to have access to the online learning platform. I need you have a lot of permissions that you need in order to teach. Well, then we make a role teacher, and it will group all the permissions that you need in order to be able to fulfill that role. So that's the best way to think of a role. Technically, it is then a many-to-many relation between users and permissions, so a role has many permissions, and then many users can fill a specific role. I'm not the only teacher at the university. You can have many teachers at the university, of course. So technically, a role relates users and permissions many-to-many. And a well-designed role, as I said, will correspond to a well-defined responsibility or job in the organization that is setting the access control policy. We add a number of additional concepts. So what will go away with role-based access control is that the owner decides everything. In a sense, with role-based access control, you will have some system-wide rules that are enforced by the guard and that are much less influenceable by individual by individual users of the system. So we add one concept, the notion of sessions. Why? Because this is not essential. You have notions of role-based access control where we don't have sessions. I'll introduce it anyway here. There are some other extensions that I don't immediately include that I'll talk about later. But sessions are interesting in the sense that if a user has many roles in an organization, and this will typically be the case in university, I'm not only a teacher, I'm also a researcher, for example. I also do administration of projects. I mean, you have many roles. So it's bad if you do something on the computer system, on a server, on our SAP system, for example. It's bad to have all your permissions active at all times. This violates what is called the principle of least privilege. From a security point of view, it's good to make sure that the power you have is limited to the power you need to do the particular task you're doing at that moment. And so sessions will help us support that. So when you start a session with a server, with a protected system in general, as a user, you can choose which of your roles you activate. You can activate them all, and then you have all your power. Or you can just activate the teacher role. If I have to reserve an auditorium, I only need my teacher role. I don't need more than that. Okay? So that's why we have sessions are separate from users in the sense that a user has all his roles, but he can then choose to start a session with only a subset of the roles active. Okay? And then that session will have all the permissions associated with activated roles on that particular session. If I activate my teacher role, I get all the teacher permissions. If I, in addition, activate my researcher role, I get also the researcher permissions and so forth. Okay? That's the informal description again. So I hope this makes sense, and I hope that you see that at least there is hope of it being more manageable, because the notion of a role should typically be more stable than the individual users. The university has had the teacher role for hundreds of years. I've only been a teacher there for a few years. So the role is a more stable concept, and hence it will have to be changed. The assignment of permissions to that role hopefully will have to be changed less often, leading to simpler administration. Okay, so again, let us try to make this precise. So by now you should read this like code. I assume all of you have some coding experience at least. So here we have again the protection state as a number of instance variables. You can think of them as instance variables. In role-based access control, you have a part of the state that's relatively stable. So this part of the state will not change, or it will be changed out of band. We don't model how this is changed. So this is assumed to be relatively stable. And if you wanted to also explain how this changes, we would need to extend the security automaton here. So this is what users do you have, what roles do you have, what basic atomic permissions do you have, and then what roles does a user have? So each user is mapped to a set of roles. And what permissions does a role have? So each role gets a set of permissions. And in a role-based access control system, this would typically be administered by some centralized administrator of the system, not by the users themselves. So that's an important difference with the DAC system we had before, where actually the system was self-managed. All users were doing things, and this impacted the protection state. With role-based access control, there's a more hierarchical view, where there is somebody who manages this, and then the system runs, and changes to this should be much less frequent than changes here. Okay, so let's assume this is constant. How does then the guard evolve over time? Well, of course, you still have sessions that come and go. Users log in and log out. And you have mappings from sessions to roles, and mappings from users. A user can have more than one session active. I can log in as a teacher, and I can log in as a researcher in two separate sessions and do separate things in these two sessions. So we keep all that state in the security automaton, in the guard, and we will use it to define when something is possible or not. And the key check, the one that I've informally explained on the previous slide, is again here. It's very succinct and it's very precise. When can a certain session use a certain permission P? So this might be the right to reserve an auditorium, for example. When can a session that I, for example, started reserve an auditorium? Well, this is the precise specification of when it's possible. If the session is a valid session, of course, this is boilerplate. And if there is some role in the session, so the session has a number of activated roles, we compute that here, there must be some role in that set of activated roles such that the permission that we're asking here is in the permissions assigned to that specific role. Yeah? And it's for this kind of notation that I use SpecSharp instead of Java. You can write this very succinctly here. So essentially this says there must be a role in the activated roles of the session that has the permission that we're looking for. And then it's allowed, and otherwise it's not allowed. Okay? So this is just a precise way of writing down what I explained informally on the previous slide. And we can have, again, some dynamicity. So what happens when a certain session is created? So here we have an action where a specific authenticated user, U, is trying to create a session, to log on to the system with this set of activated roles. So when I log in, I say I want to log in as a teacher and a researcher. So what should the guard check? The users should be valid, of course. And this is the key check. The roles that he's trying to activate are a subset of the roles assigned to this user. I should not activate the role chancellor if this role has not been assigned to me in the assignment of users to roles. Yeah, that's the key idea. And then here is how you update the state. You create a new session, add it to the set of sessions, write down that for this session, this is the set of activated roles, and that now this user has one additional session S. So you add it to the set of sessions for this specific user, and so forth. Okay. Again, I hope. So in a sense, this is maybe being a bit annoyingly precise, but doing that is useful from the point of view of access control. This will allow you to communicate what rules should be enforced and how they should be enforced in a very precise way to people who then actually have to implement the rules. It's also a way of reasoning about what could go wrong with when we set these rules. Yeah, could people still, within these rules, find a way to do something bad, yes or no? So you can analyze the rules at a relatively understandable but precise level of abstraction. Again, RBAC, just as discretionary access control, has plenty of extensions. One is hierarchies. So you can have, if you start to identify all the roles in a specific organization, you will find that there is some structure in these roles. Sometimes you have roles that are sub-roles of others. Here is a very simple example. You may have the role of engineer in an engineering company. This gives a lot of rights, permissions that are common to all engineers. And then you have an engineer working on project A, which gives him additional permissions. A project A engineer could be another role. A project B engineer is yet another role. These will have all the permissions that any engineer has and some additional ones. And this one, these people in this role will have all the permissions of an engineer and some additional ones. And then the director of engineering is another role. He may have all the permissions associated with all projects, just for the sake of the example. Well, in that case, you could make the inheritance relation among these roles explicit and further simplify the administration of permissions. So now, if a new permission, there's a new system being installed, a calendaring system, and all engineers need access to it, well, you add the permissions to access that system to the engineer role, and everybody has them. If project A installs a specific additional service, and only the project A engineers need, you add it to one place, and it's solved. Again, this is just a way to improve administration, the possible administration of the system. Okay, and a final extension that you could do with RBAC. Again, the most implementations of RBAC are relatively sparse in how they implement these extensions. So if you have role-based access control in J2E, for example, does not necessarily implement all these extensions. But what you can add as another extension are constraints. Let me just look at the example of static constraints. So you can specify in the specification of your role-based access control policy that not any combination of roles is okay for a user. So it's bad for users to have specific combinations of roles. And you can use that to implement separation of duty. Separation of duty is, again, a security principle that says that in order to do something, it's good that at least two people have to be involved. So to avoid stealing stuff with company money, you might want to say that ordering something and approving payment of it should be done by two different people. Experience shows that if people can do something bad alone, they're much more likely to do it than when they have to team up with somebody for the obvious psychological reasons. So that's a good principle. The fact that certain permissions should never be unified in one person, you can express that with these kinds of constraints in role-based access control. You might say that nobody can both have a role in which he can order goods and approve payment for them, for example. And that you have other kinds of constraints that I'm not going to focus on. Role-based access control in practice, I'll come back to implementation techniques later. We see this is implemented mainly in databases or in specific applications like SAP-based applications. There are typically many operating systems, although they are at the core discretionary, try to simulate roles using the group concept that you have in discretionary access control. For example, in Windows, you have some, let's say, the backup operators group or the administrators group for that fact. These are groups, even from the name, you can tell that they're more like roles. Still, there are some disadvantages when you use a group versus a role that I'm not going to go into. But you see that even in discretionary systems, the notion of role is being simulated. And then maybe most importantly, from the point of view of application level access control, is application servers implement this in a generic way so that you can easily apply role-based access control to your own applications. And I'll come back to that when we talk about implementation in a minute. Okay, I think this finishes my overview of the models. Yes?
Any drawbacks
of role-based access control? Well,
because you presented some of...
Yeah, that's a very good point. Okay, yeah, but, that's a very good point. So, the main weaknesses I think of are the ones that have to do with limitations of specific implementations. So, for example, if you don't have hierarchies, then managing permissions may still be a lot of work. I think that the use of the notion of a role in itself is just a good idea. The question is, you usually need to combine it with other things. For example, role-based access control as it stands does not support some kind of workflow where what you can do depends on in what state of a process you are. And in some cases you need that, and you could say it's a disadvantage of role-based access control that it doesn't support that. Because as we'll see, role-based access control is offered by infrastructure, so J2EE may offer you a role-based access control model. But if it doesn't support the additional concepts you need to write the rules that you want to enforce down precisely, then you need to break out of the infrastructural support that there is for RBAC and do something programmatically, and that will be an important disadvantage. So I think the notion of owner-based access control is fundamentally flawed in many cases. In many cases, you don't want somebody who creates the information to always have full access over it for his lifetime. That's typically not, especially in a company context. I mean, the guy who's doing it is just doing it
for the company in a sense. So that you could say it's fundamentally wrong in the sense that it was built for operating systems for personal computers maybe, but doesn't fit application level resources. I think for the notion of role, I don't think it's fundamentally flawed. It's just a good concept. It's a concept that you can use and it will typically reduce your administrative burden. And the limitations are more in the combination, the lack of combination with other features. Okay, let me say a bit about implementation. So in order to talk about implementation, I first going to talk briefly about how discretionary access control is implemented in Windows. Just a few slides. Why? Well, one, it will give you an idea that to implement it, you typically use completely different data structures than you would use in the security automaton. Secondly, I explain it because later we'll see that for applications, you use infrastructural support for access control, and then understanding the Windows access control model will help you understand how access control can be done in applications running on top of Windows, for example, on COM+ or .NET and so forth. Okay? So I need to say a little bit about something that's maybe a bit too low level for some of you, but I need to say a little bit about it. So for Windows, the principals are users or machines, and they're identified by what is called SITs, security identifiers, and authentication will make sure that the right security identifier is attached to somebody coming to a machine or somebody remotely logging into a machine. I'm not going to talk about authentication. Windows has a mechanism of supporting local authentication on a machine or supporting domain-based authentication for a big organization. I'm not going to talk about it. Again, authentication is not in the scope of this session. Just remember that authentication is a complicated beast. It may require Kerberos protocols being executed between domain controllers and so forth. But in the end, and that's all we need to know for access control, it makes sure that every process or every threat, any active entity on a Windows machine, ends up with an access token attached to it that contains all the relevant information for access control. And we'll see in a minute in detail what is in there, but that's the essence of what authentication does. Somebody tries to do something on the machine, so he has to start some process or some thread to do something. Well, that process or thread will have an access token attached to it. And that you need to remember, and then the fact that internally Windows uses these security identifiers to represent users, because we'll see SITs coming back in the data structures in access tokens, for example. Okay, so that's the subject part, the principal part. Now the object part, or the protected system, the Windows operating system recognizes a number of operating system objects. The most typical one are files, but devices, registry keys, and so forth are also examples of objects. The operating system calls securable objects. So these are the objects on which access control will be applied. Yeah? And every securable object has as metadata what is called a security descriptor. So we have every thread as an access token, every object has a security descriptor. That's the essence of what you need to know to understand how access control works. So what is in an access token? In an access token you have the security identifier of the SID of the user. So that's what authentication has filled in. It's one of the things that authentication has filled in. And then there are two ways of defining groups in Windows. And this will be important later on for application level access control. So you have in Windows what is called global groups. And they are defined by the authority doing the authentication. So that can be your machine, but typically in a big organization, it will be the domain controller. And they should reflect the organizational structure. So these are real groups. In the sense like it's the sales department could be a group, the department of computer science, or that specific research group. And so there are subsets of users at the organizational level. That's how you're supposed to use global groups. Windows supports another kind of group called, and these are recognized across the entire domain. So if you have a domain-based Windows with a domain controller and 10,000 users and 1,000 machines, each of the machines will know about the global groups. Because they reflect organizational structure. You have local groups that only have meaning on one specific machine. Yeah? And these you should typically use as to simulate role-based access control. I'll come back to how Windows supports you in the COM+ application server supports things to make it very easy to do role-based access control with these local groups. So these are called local groups, or sometimes also aliases in the literature on Windows access control. So they only have meaning on a specific machine. If I go to this machine, I may have this local group. If I go to the next machine, I may not have it. And so they should reflect roles that have meaning to the applications running on this machine. If this machine is running an e-commerce shop, I could have the role customer there. If I go to the next machine that's running a calendaring system, I will not have that role there. Okay? We'll see in a minute how this is used in applications. But so keep in mind the difference between global groups and local groups. And then, in addition, the access token has a number of privileges that will be less important for applications, and I will not zoom into them. These are mainly for operating system level activities. Okay, so we have threads with access tokens. I told you what's in them. We now have securable objects with security descriptors. What is in them? The seat of the owner. So remember, we have discretionary access control. Every object has an owner. Well, this is, of course, in the security descriptor. Then this is there for legacy reasons. It's not used anymore. And then this is the important part for access control, what's called the DACL, the discretionary access control list. I'll zoom in. This essentially summarizes what the owner has given away as rights. And I'll zoom into the DACL in a minute. And then you have what is called the SACL, or the system access control list. It's completely similar to the DACL, except that instead of specifying what's allowed or not, it specified what should be audited and what not. So I'll zoom in only on the DACL further on, but the SACL is, in a broader security perspective, is auditing is as important as access control, of course. Okay, so here's what the DACL looks like. It's a sorted list of ACEs, access control entries, and each access control entry denies or grants a specific access right to a seat. It can be a group or a user. Yeah? So for example, this access control entry says user X is denied read and write on the object that this DACL is attached to. Group G is allowed read and write on the object that this DACL is attached to, and so forth. So here you see that the way in which rights are implemented is completely different than in the security automaton we talked about before. The rights are attached to the object that they talk about, in a sense, whereas we kept them centrally in the security automaton. And then there are Windows have specific rules on order. So the simple rule is order matters. So the first match of an access control entry with a specific request decides. So you should put deny entries early, so that if something is denied, it's found first by Windows instead of... So if X would be a member of group G, then this would still deny user X because this is first in the list. If you would swap the order of these two, Windows would find an allow for X because X is a member of group G and it would allow it. So first match decides. So it's more a performance implementation decision than a fundamental choice. Okay, so now you understand all the data structures and the actual access check is simpler. So for each access to a securable object, the kernel will iterate over the access control entries, match against the information in the access token of the thread that is doing the access, and then based on the first match, make a decision. So here is a simple example taken from the MSDN library documentation. This thread, if it tries to access this object with this DACL, will get a denied, an access denied. Why? Because Johnson, the actual user here, the first access control entry says that access for Johnson is denied. So even though group A is allowed, the fact that Johnson is in group A doesn't matter anymore. First match decide. And this thread is given access. Why? Well, this access control entry doesn't match. It's not relevant. This one does match. It's about group A. So, and it's an allow. So this thread is allowed access. Yeah? So I think no surprises there.
If you would avoid the Johnson, and then you have group A, B, and C, will you then only have write access? Or will you have because he's in G?
Yeah. So if this is not Johnson but Frank, for example, he would have, and he is trying to read, it would be allowed. So this is not. Then this entry would not match. Why? Because the operation doesn't match. Yeah? So the fact that this allows group A to write is not the same as denying all the rest write. So the type of the entry, a deny entry or an allow entry, matters. Yeah. So you can have a deny and allow entry, and then you have rules on whether the entry matches yes or no. And for this case, if this is Frank instead of Johnson, and he's trying to read or execute, it would just not match. Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'm going to skip this because I see I will be in trouble with respect to time. I absolutely want to say something about how you now implement access control in your applications, and that's what we'll talk about now. You have many of options there, and of course it also depends on what kind of application you're talking about. Are you talking about a Windows server? Are you talking about a web server? Are you talking about a database? Are you talking about a local application on a machine? I will talk about the different implementation options you have, and also try to say a bit where they are applicable for what kind of applications. I think what I will say here is valid at some level of abstraction for applications on all kinds of platforms. I will give specific examples on Windows because it sometimes will tie in with the Windows access control system that we talked about. But similar concepts and similar solutions exist in all other platforms. Yeah? And we can, if necessary, discuss about what would this be like on the Java or J2E side if you care to ask about that. So basically, I'll talk about four things you can do. A very simple solution is delegate access control to the operating system. You can rely on an application server. This is a very common technique. You can use enterprise security middleware, like IBM Tivoli, for example, is a famous package. Or you can implement your own access control and maybe use some other infrastructural components to help you, like Jim talked about this Apache Shiro framework. This is something that could help you roll your own access control in an application. Okay, so first approach, delegate to the operating system. So the basic idea here is that in the application, you avoid doing any access checks yourself. Instead, you try to map application resources to operating system resources. If every application resource can be mapped to a file, then why not let the operating system do access control, because it's already doing access control to files? Yeah. So, for example, an example where you absolutely would use this kind of implementation technique is if this is a file server. It would in most cases be useless to redo access control on files. The operating system is already doing it. But you may be able to do it for other kinds of applications too. And a common trick that you see there is, so another kind of protected resource in Windows access control are registry keys. And you see sometimes applications registering registry keys to represent application resources and then use Windows access control to this registry key to check whether access to that resource is used, yes or no. So for a file server, it would be obvious to do this. As application resources move further and further away from operating system resources, it gets less and less obvious to do it this way, although there are some tricks to be able to do it anyway, like the trick with registry keys. So why is this good? This is good because it's very hard to do it wrong. So essentially what the application here does is it authenticates the user, and then this leads to the creation of an access token for that user. You stick that on the thread that will execute the user request. So typically this is a server, of course. And then the thread runs with the access token of the user, and it can only do what that user is allowed to do on the system, period. The operating system take care of it, and you cannot make any mistakes in your application. That's the good thing. The bad thing is, so this only makes sense if the kind of resources you're trying to protect access to map to operating system resources. If not, it doesn't make sense. Say if you have medical records, and these medical records do not map one-on-one on files, well, probably doing this kind of thing, it doesn't match. There's an impedance mismatch. But that's your first implementation option. Second, and very, and this is probably one of the more common implementation techniques, is to rely on an application server. So an application server is something like J2EE, COMPLUS, .NET, and so forth. You can think of it as a kind of an operating system for applications that provides additional services to any applications running on top of it. These services run from easy access to persistent storage to enforcing security, among which access control. So you can think of it as the application server will intercept any request coming from a user outside. Again, this is typically a server, of course. It will intercept anyway any request coming from the user and going to the application. It will intercept the request for many reasons, to do concurrency control, to support persistency, to support transactions and so forth. So it can also use that interception to do security. Okay, and the typical check, so what most application servers support is that for each of the entry points into the applications, the methods that the application offers, you can specify roles that the user needs to have in order to be able to access that method. And then you have some configuration of the application server that says, okay, and these users have these roles. Again, in Windows, this is made very convenient, and it relies a lot on the access control infrastructure in the operating system, and it uses the local groups that I talked about before. So what Complus and in extension.net, that's built on Complus, will do for you is, on interception, it will look in the access token of the user accessing the application for local group seats and interpret these as roles. Okay? So if this is an e-commerce shop application and I come as a user to this machine, during authentication I will get the global and local group seats that I talked about. Now the local group seats are the roles defined on this specific machine, and it may include a customer role, for example. And then the application developer can configure the application server to only allow certain entry points in the application if there is a corresponding role, local seat, present in the access token. Yeah? So you see that you reuse again a lot of the operating system infrastructure in order to do role-based access control. And other application servers offer a similar model, except that for authentication, for example, Java and J2EE does not rely on operating system services for the authentication. You'll need to use a third-party library, something like JAWS, for example, in order to do the authentication. But then, in essence, they offer the same kind of functionality. The application server will intercept any request, and it offers you a configuration with which you can say, these users belong to these roles, and these entry points in the application are callable by these roles. So it offers a very simple form of role-based access control. Okay, so that's your second implementation option. A third implementation option is that's a bit related, is the use of security middleware, specific security middleware. For example, I mentioned the Tivoli Access suite from IBM. Microsoft has something similar. I think it's called ASMAN or Authorization Manager. I don't know it that well. So essentially what you can do with these systems is you have an ID a bit similar to the ID here, except that you can even have it across many applications running on different machines. So you may have different applications offered to the intranet or to the internet, for example, as web applications. And then you put one reverse proxy in front of them all that essentially gets to see all interactions that users may potentially have with your various application servers. And then here you define a policy for the entire space. So if you think of these as web applications, you can think of it as a kind of a tree with URLs that should be accessible or not be accessible. So you have a large object space here, and here you can write policies about who can access what object in that object space. And then each of the tools that offer this, so for example IBM Tivoli, they come with their own policy language in order to specify the policies on this object space that you're trying to protect. And again, typically these are typically more elaborate than just role. They support role-based access control, but they also support additional constraints on top of role-based access control and so forth. Okay, and an important advantage, so this is called the policy enforcement point. This is the place where interception is happening. This is called the policy decision point. This is where you configure the logic about who can access what. And typically here you have a substantially more powerful policy language than you have in a standard J2EE or Complus application container. And finally, the last thing you can do is do it yourself, roll your own. So essentially what you will do is, in your application, you will write explicit security checks. This is extremely common, especially for web applications. This is common, that users write access control checks in the application. The advantage of this is, you can do anything you want. I mean, there's no you're not limited by a policy language. You're not limited by the fact that all decisions should be taken at one specific point. You can take a decision after having done some computation and so forth. So it's extremely flexible. The disadvantage is it's extremely tricky to get right. So if you forget an access check in one place, this is a hole in your application. And again, many techniques have been thought of to make that easier. So you have ways in which you can put access control in your application by means of annotations, so that it's easier to put security checks in your code, but you still put them in your code. And if you forget an annotation, you're basically dead. You have aspect-oriented approaches, where you can basically specify there should be an access check on all these methods. So for those of you who are familiar with the various approaches to aspect orientation, they basically allow you to quantify over different program points and say some additional logic must be added at all these program points. And you can say, okay, at all these program points there should be an access check. And that makes it a bit less likely that you forget stuff. But still, it is dangerous in the sense that the complete mediation property that you get when the operating system or some security middleware is helping you is very difficult to get right in this kind of system. Something that in any case makes sense to do if you do roll your own access control is to still externalize as much as possible about the access control rules themselves, because they may change over time. So if you want to add an additional access control rule or you want to change some rule and you have to do it throughout your code base, this is a nightmare. So preferably what you do is you just say, you indicate in your code the places where a certain access check needs to be done. And then you delegate to a policy decision point that you can configure with a policy where you can more easily change the actual policy that needs to be enforced. And security middleware like Tivoli will typically also offer you an API to query from your application the policy decision point so that you can reuse policies that you've written for other applications, for example, in your own application. And this is an area where, so Jim told about the Apache Shiro framework. This is an example of a framework that will help you to write these kinds of in-application access checks consistently. You can do it, I don't know Shiro very well, but you can do it with attributes, you can do it with programmatically writing code and so forth. Okay. I think this finishes my part on the state of the art in access control. I have 2 minutes left, I think, according to timing. So let me first check whether there are any questions so far. I think so. I finished one, and the most important part of the presentation here. If there are questions, I'd be happy to go into them now. And otherwise, I'll give a 1 minute summary of the second part. But it's more important to make sure that the first part came across and that there are no issues there. If not, let me try to summarize in 1 minute what I wanted to say in the second part. So the second part is, in any case, more forward-looking. It's not what you can use today. It's more in what direction are we going with respect to research. Well, an issue with all the access control models we discussed so far is they assume that all the software on the system that we want to protect can be trusted. And for a server, that often makes sense. So a request from a user is coming in, we do some access checks, and then we start running, but we can trust that the code on the server is doing what we expect it to do. However, in many other scenarios, we don't have that guarantee. I gave you the example of Trojan horses on operating system. A user may be opening an editor, and then it's no longer reasonable to assume that the editor is doing what the user wants it to do. So the software may be doing completely, the user may be opening a file and thinking, okay, this is what the program is doing, it's just accessing a file, it will be using my rights to do that. But the editor may, behind its back, actually be deleting all the user's files, copying them, sending them to the internet and so forth. You have no idea. So if you have some untrusted piece of software on the protected system, you have a lot of additional challenges. And this was recognized in the 60s, and some ideas on how to deal with it were thought through, and they never worked. But this problem is coming back with a vengeance these days. So for example, a web application today, at the client side, you will typically include a lot of code from other parties, JavaScript, for example, that will run with the access rights of the user and or the application that the user is interacting with, and that may be malicious. It could be a Trojan horse. So we will have talks later in this week that that show you that JavaScript that you include in that web application can be malicious. So in that sense, any kind of access control that the browser or the server at the other side would be implementing should not assume that the scripts that are running are doing what the user is intending them to do. So if the script is sending all kinds of requests to the server, you can no longer definitely be sure that they come from the user. There may be some malicious code in there. Yeah? The same for apps on your smartphone. You may have an app on your smartphone. Access control on your smartphone is in a sense trivial because it's all owned by you. There's only one user, so you have access to everything. But now you have these apps there. The way they handle that today is, okay, you can put some access control on the app. It's very badly done. People typically don't even look at what permissions they give to apps. But even if you give them permissions, as soon as you give an app a permission to read something and a permission to go to the internet, it can channel a lot of private information about you to the internet. And apps are doing that. I mean, people have shown that. There are empirical studies that show that both JavaScript and apps are leaking your private information all over the place. So what we need to extend access control is some notions of usage control or information flow control. These are ways in which we can give a program access to information, but then keep on limiting what it can do with it. So we can give a program access to our private information, but we can make sure that it doesn't leak it directly or indirectly to the internet, for example. And that's what usage control or information flow control are trying to do. This has been given up in the 60s for operating systems because they couldn't get it to work very well. Research has progressed in the meantime. There are much better. So the technique that was tried for operating system is called mandatory access control. I'm not going to explain it here, but the bottom line is it never really worked well. There are now refinements of mandatory access control that can be much more precise, that can track the flow of information through a program much better. And I think this is one of the areas in which we are heading. So we will not just have access control as you know it and that I talked about in the majority of the course, but for systems where there is some piece of untrusted software, usually client systems like your web browser or your mobile phone, we will have techniques that in addition do usage control and or information flow control. With that, I'm already exceeded my minute. So I will stop there. Again, I'd be happy to talk in more detail to anybody who's interested offline. So I'll be here the whole day. So come and grab me if you're interested to know more. And that also goes for unclarities or extensions of the other topics I talked about. Don't hesitate. Because I didn't get that many questions, I must say. Interactivity, I don't know if it's a bad or a good sign. But in any case, come and talk to me if you have additional questions. Thank you.